Permit me to invite my panelists for this panel discussion. Dr. Angela George from Royal Marsden, London, has already been introduced to you. Pleasure to invite Dr. Sudeep Gupta. Dr. Sudeep Gupta is one of the foremost breast cancer medical oncologists in the country. He is a professor of medical oncology at the Tata Memorial Cancer Center in Mumbai. He is also the director of the ACTRAC institution at Mumbai, which is a part of the Tata Institute. Dr. Vinay Deshmane, very senior breast cancer surgeon trained in England, my very dear friend. We trained in oncology together. We have some very fond memories of the 10th floor of the Tata Memorial Cancer Center. Very happy to welcome Vinay. And Dr. Reema Pathak, you've already heard. She is Associate Professor of Radiation Oncology at the Tata Hospital and also very actively involved in the breast cancer genetic clinic at the Tata Hospital. Dr. Raja Pramik is Associate Professor in Medical Oncology at the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And he is a very active contributor to the document which our president, Dr. Govind Babu, is going to release to you, the Indian Consensus Document on Hereditary Breast and Ovarian Cancer. Dr. Nikita Mehta is Associate Professor of Medical Oncology at the Adyar Cancer Center in South India, Chennai. She's also a very active contributing member of this document. And in addition to being a very active clinician, she has a very active lab interest also, and she works in Dr. Rajkumar's lab. Dr. Aparna Dhar is a molecular pathologist par excellence, in charge of the molecular pathology laboratory at the Core Laboratories in Delhi, and she's also trained in genetic counseling. Dr. Priya Srinivas is scientist F at the cancer department of the Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Biotechnology at Thiruvananthapuram, and she's had 15-20 years of laboratory experience in BRCA1, BRCA2 testing. So we have an illustrious panel. We have a surgeon, we have a top medical oncologist, we have radiation oncologists, we have a genetic counselor and a laboratory expert, and we have a hardcore scientist. So I think we should bring out some of the issues which we face in our country. So this is my institution. Welcome to this panel discussion and this program. And some of you will remember this cover of the Newsweek. You can see that this figure is a 59-year-old lady with breast cancer. Her daughter had a preventive mastectomy. Now the daughter's daughter, like this lady's granddaughter, is 5 years old. Now what to do with that patient? Should she be tested? Should you mess up her psychology right at teenage time? So these are some questions which still are looking for which we are still looking for answers, and we'll see what consensus we can come to as we do the panel discussion. So all cancers arise from genes, but not all cancers are inherited. 80% of the breast cancers are sporadic. 20% are 15 to 20% are familial cancers, of which 5 to 10% there is a strong hereditary transmission. And if you could see here, 100 cases of breast cancer, 80 are sporadic, 10 to 15 are familial, and 5 to 10% are hereditary. And this is the difference between a sporadic cancer and a hereditary cancer. Higher risk of developing cancers in patients with hereditary cancers, younger age of onset, usually less than 50 years, and they can be multiple primary cancers. So let's do a case-based discussion. Let me present the first case capsule to you. This is regarding a patient with breast cancer with a strong family history. We have a 46-year-old premenopausal lady, educated, works in a bank, has dense breasts since adolescence, multiple cysts in the past, now noticed a new lump in the right upper quadrant. It's not going away, it's getting bigger, but she cannot feel any lumps in the axilla. She's been married for 21 years, has 3 children, one girl is 19 years old. She regularly self-examines her breast, gets a pap smear done every 2 years, past history of asthma, hypertension. but exercises regularly, and no history of tobacco, alcohol, or drugs. All the three kids were born after 25 years of age, first period at 11 years of age, and she has a history of cysts in her breast. There's a strong family history with this patient of ours. Her mother was diagnosed with breast cancer at age 45, in the premenopausal age, died at age 73 because of recurrence of the breast cancer. She has a sister who at age 40 has breast cancer. Paternal history, the patient's grandmother, as we call it, Nani, is diagnosed with breast cancer at early age. Patient's aunt, maternal auntie, we call it Masi, is diagnosed with CA ovary. And the paternal side, the patient's maternal uncle or mama has early onset cancer prostate. This is a mammogram by 2.9, 3.2 centimeters spectulated mass, few axillary lymph nodes. Ultrasound is a non-cystic mass. Biopsy is infiltrating duct carcinoma. The core biopsy is positive for the hormone receptors and negative for HER2. So an MRM is done. The pathological staging is T2N1M0. Again, ER/PR and positive, but HER2 negative. She receives standard adjuvant chemotherapy followed by radiotherapy and tamoxifen with LHRH agonist for 2 years. This is the family tree of the patient. This is our index patient. A sister who has breast cancer. Mother has breast cancer. One aunt has ovarian cancer, and in the earlier generation, again, there is history of breast cancer. So now this is an easy question. Let me ask Nikita this. Nikita, is genetic testing indicated in this patient? Nikita, can you unmute yourself and answer?
Yes, sir. Absolutely, she's a premenopausal. She's a young lady with an extremely strong positive, strong family history of breast cancer and prostate. There's absolutely no doubt that she does require genetic testing.
Yeah, so it is pretty ambiguous and pretty obvious to everybody, even somebody who's not initiated in breast cancer genetics, that this is a family in which there is some genetic predisposition is there, and this patient must be tested. So before testing, let me ask this to Dr. Aparna Dhar. Before testing and asking for genetic tests, is there something else which you should do and which you should do in all the patients?
Aparna? I think it's very, very important doing a pre-test genetic counseling. It is important that before a patient signs up for any type of genetic test, they do go in with informed consent, which means they understand why are they eligible for this testing. They need to understand that if they do come positive or they come negative, or even if they get a variance of uncertain significance, how is this applicable to them and to the rest of their family? So I think pre-test counseling is very, very important. You have to help address the patient's questions as to why they've been referred to your clinic. And also in doing so, in them understanding what their disease is, because genetic counseling is a communication process. So just explaining to them why their disease is and its repercussions for the rest of the family.
Yeah, I think that is very important, and that should be an extremely important take-home message for the people who are listening to this webinar, that just writing a genetic test, BRCA1, BRCA2 testing, germline, somatic, is not the way to go. Before you do that, you have to sit down with the patient. Either you sit down with the patient or refer the patient to an expert genetic counselor, and a pre-test counseling is absolutely vital. And this is the list of things which you have to cover in the pre-test counseling. I obviously don't have time to go through all this, but all this has to be on a form and has to be checklisted before you just simply prescribe testing for familial cancer or testing for BRCA1, BRCA2. This is absolutely vitally important. And you know, I think this is becoming important enough, not only in breast cancer, not only in ovarian cancer, in all other cancers, this genetic predisposition is coming. And I think it is just a matter of time before it will be mandated, at least in cancer centers, maybe in all medical college hospitals, that there should be a person who is expert in genetic counseling. So this is a question, I think, is Dr. Sudeep Gupta on board? Sudeep, are you there?
I'm there, Dr. Malhotra, but you know, my signals are very bad today, so I'm not sure. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you very clearly. So Dr. Sudeep, as one of the leading breast cancer experts in this country and dealing with these patients right and left, and having one of the best breast cancer genetic clinics in the country, if a patient like this comes to you, what test or tests would you prescribe for this patient?
Sorry, you know, I got disconnected when you were presenting the case.
Okay, this is a patient, young premenopausal patient with breast cancer.
Yeah, maybe ask them.
Okay, maybe I'll ask Reema. Reema, you are there. You are in charge of one of the best breast cancer genetic clinics in the country. Maybe you have competition from Dr. Rajkumar's clinic at Adyar. What genetic tests would you ask for in this patient? Can you very clearly tell our listeners that what tests in this patient who has a very strong family history of cancer, what would you ask for? Reema?
So here we can typically say that she has a hereditary breast and ovarian cancer syndrome, because she has breast cancer on both sides of her family, and she also has prostate cancer in the family, and that too young. So we can probably order just a BRCA1, BRCA2 gene panel, but if that turns out to be negative, then a multi-gene panel NGS testing should be done. So whenever you're doing limited testing, you should tell the patient that there is a possibility, even though small, that the test results may be negative. And whenever we are doing only BRCA1 and BRCA2, MLPA testing also should be done with it, so that large genomic deletions are not missed.
And you would do it on the germ, you would do germline testing or somatic?
Germline testing. For inherited, for knowing inherited mutation status, we would do germline testing.
And would you ask for an NGS or would you ask for a Sanger sequencing?
So NGS is obviously easier. We do Sanger sequencing as well at TMH. We do our, because it's more, it's not service oriented, it's more research oriented at our lab, we do something called as frequently found mutations. It's easier on the pocket. So based on geo-ethnicity of this patient, we would know that she may have a certain few mutations, and we would first test for those point mutations in these patients. And if those are negative, then go in for an NGS panel.
So Raja, are you there? Dr. Raja Pramik, you work at a top institution of the country, the All India Institute at Delhi. What would be your approach? Like, what are patients at AIIMS offer in this situation? Do you do an NGS? Do you do a Sanger? Do you also include MLPA to detect the large genetic deletions? What is the approach at AIIMS, Raja?
Yes, sir. So for this, for this family, while I'm doing the pre-test counseling, I like to know whether, in view of the strong family history, has this test ever been done on this patient, first of all, because you showed in the pedigree that there is some mutations were detected. So if the mutation is already detected in the family beforehand, many years ago, then I like to go for this for single site testing. Otherwise, if it is a de novo proband, this proband has come for the first time and there is no testing in the family, then my test of choice is NGS multigene panel on the germline mutations. This panel will definitely include BRCA1 and 2 and a few of the other moderate penetrance genes as well, because the cost of testing is similar. And then I asked the lab to do a reflexly LGR MLPA for large genomic deletions and duplications if the test for BRCA1 and 2 is negative. So it's already there for reflex testing. So NGS followed by reflex testing.
I think that's very, very clear, and I think that's very well said. I'd like to ask Dr. Priya. Priya, if you go back to the lab, how difficult it is to do BRCA testing? What are the practical problems which you encounter? Both for Sanger as well as NGS. Priya, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. First of all, I just would like to comment on the other question, the first question about this particular patient. So, as far as we know, that you have already told, sir, from one parent side, the mutation is very specific. So, and the other parent side, there is a mutation in BRCA2. 7429. So just a particular exon amplification will be enough, and then sequencing of that particular sequence, part of the gene amplification will be sufficient enough to identify the mutation in that particular patient, because she's carrying mutation from both sites, and we already know which mutation she is having. So the expense of doing the experiment, doing the analysis for that particular patient is very low compared to analyzing the whole gene with the next gen sequencing or Sanger sequencing, if at all. So mostly people now do Sanger sequencing, but in many companies they do particular exons. Maybe they select 4 or 5 exons. The problem here is that when we give samples for testing in these centers, they will look for certain hotspots only. So for example, in Ashkenazi Jews, we have certain particular mutations. So they will be having those mutations into considering when they analyze, and they will analyze that particular mutation. And maybe 5 or 6 hotspots they will select and do amplification and analyze it, rather than going for a whole gene sequencing. So in that case, we miss out a lot of mutations. So that possibility is there in this particular case. In my mind, Dr. Angila was explaining, this is the case with hereditary breast ovarian cancers, but we have the rest of the sporadic population where they also have this BRCA1 gene mutation. So we have to consider that also. That's my comment, sir. Thank you.
Aparna, you have a comment? You work at one of the really good labs in our country. Your opinion on this?
So I completely agree. The fact that if there is a known mutation, as it's shown in the family tree, then in that case, I do send it in for a basic mutation specific testing, which is usually a Sanger sequencing to confirm that particular mutation. Only in the case when I don't know what the mutation is and there is a very strong family history, as we have here in this particular case, then in that one, I do send it for a multi-gene testing, a hereditary panel, where we are looking at the main genes, at least the genes in the DNA damage repair pathway that are associated with hereditary breast and ovarian cancer. So cost-wise, it is the same. And I do like doing NGS plus MLPA simultaneously, just so that I get 100% gene coverage.
Okay, so let's move on. This patient opted for, this was, you know, she had an NGS done with a MLPA, and they showed up this class 2 mutation. Now my question to Dr. Vinay is that, Vinay, for a patient who has a strong family history and also a deleterious BRCA1 mutation, would you be comfortable in offering this patient breast conserving surgery, or would you insist for MRM? Vinay?
I would be quite comfortable in offering breast conserving surgery to the patient, although there is a move towards BRCA patients not doing very well with breast conserving. That hasn't really been proven. So all of them don't really have to undergo a mastectomy.
So are you saying that it doesn't make any difference whether the patient has a BRCA mutation or not?
Yes. BRCA mutation doesn't contraindicate a breast conserving procedure.
Because then you will have to give this patient adjuvant radiotherapy.
Yes.
Is that controversy at rest now, that you can do that without any added risk?
More or less, the data has not shown that they do worse. Let's put it that way. So as long as we don't have definitive proof that this patient is going to do badly with a breast conservation, there is really no need to withhold a breast conserving procedure.
Right. And the second question is also to you. This is a patient who has a very strong family history. I mean, you can't have a strong family history stronger than this. So would you wait for the BRCA mutation to come before you decide the treatment? Suppose the patient says that she wants an MRF, or you know, she tells you that if I have a genetic problem, then I would prefer an MRM. Otherwise, you can go ahead with the breast cancer surgery. Would you wait for that 2-3 week period, or what would you do? What would be your?
I think what was discussed earlier, that is your pre-test counseling and discussion, is actually the most important aspect of this.
Yeah.
The patient needs to be told when we discuss breast conserving about the mastectomy, also about the controversy with radiation, all those things really have to be discussed. So this is going to be a long consultation. It's not one of those. You sometimes have to give the patient time. I in fact ask the patient also to read up on the net and come back, so that they are quite sure of the treatment that they're getting and they're convinced. Because if they take multiple opinions, as what happens in our country very often, then they are going to get differing opinions.
Yeah.
So a well-versed patient and well-educated patient is one of the best to treat. Once they are convinced that they are getting the right treatment, it's very easy to go ahead. Then you're discussing genetic testing. Counseling, as I said, is the most important, because we face a lot of difficulties actually in the clinic. And when you are in a breast center outside of a general hospital setting, patients have options. Now, luckily, the turnover for genetic testing is actually quite, you can get them sometimes as low as 2 to 3 weeks, you can get a report today in Bombay. So, you know, the turnaround time is, if the patient is quite sure, after you counsel them about genetic testing, that they want a mastectomy, and you discuss a contralateral prophylactic mastectomy with or without reconstruction as per the patient's wants. If the patient is very keen, then I think you could wait. And especially with the ER positive tumor, if you feel worried, you could even put them on new adjuvant, the same treatment for that period if the patient is worried.
So can I ask Dr. Sudeep to come in? Sudeep, what is your personal preference for a patient who has a BRCA mutation and a strong family history? Are you comfortable with advising those patients? If the patient tells you that, sir, you decide for me, I can't make up my mind, then what would you be comfortable with the breast conserving surgery with radiation, or would you suggest MRM? Dr. Sudeep? Sudeep, are you there? Can you hear me? So I don't think Sudeep is there. Dr. Angela, what is the consensus in India now, where I have no hesitation in saying that you are more advanced with regards to genetic counseling as compared to our country? Is this controversy at rest that giving radiation to these patients is not a problem? Dr. Angela?
So I'd actually agree with all the things that have been said so far. I think if we had a patient like this, the discussion would be had with them. Ideally, we would have the result before surgery, or if it came back after their primary surgery and they had a wide local excision, we would have a discussion with the patient about their options, either to go back and have a completion mastectomy and a contralateral risk-reducing mastectomy with reconstructions, or whether they go ahead with the planned radiation treatment and then have high-risk screening thereafter, which would be with annual MRIs and mammograms. And it varies hugely from patient to patient. We will have some patients who will want a surgical solution, who will be very clear in their minds. And we will have others who are very keen to avoid more expensive surgery and will be happy to continue with high-risk screening. So it's a very personal decision from patient to patient, but we would discuss both options with them.
All right, thank you. So, you know, more than 2,600 mutations have been described in BRCA1, BRCA2. And there is a peculiar problem of, you know, there are several other genes which are also involved in familial disease. Most of the times, the transmission is autosomal dominant. So I think we've already talked about this. In the interest of time, I will go there. And I think this is important for our audience to know, that if the patient has both BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations, then the chances of developing breast cancer is between 50 to 85%. while as compared to the general population, it is only 11%. With BRCA1 mutation, the chances of and developing ovarian cancer is 40 to 60% by the age of 70, and slightly less if you have only the BRCA2 mutation. So I think we've already discussed this, so we can move forward. So this is a question I'd like to ask Raja. Raja, other than patients who have a strong family history of breast and ovarian cancer, which is the subgroup of patients who should be offered genetic testing?
Yes, sir. The consensus is very clear in the NCCN guidelines of who else should be offered this genetic testing. For the personal history of cancer, other than breast and ovarian, all metastatic pancreatic cancers should have genetic testing. All prostate cancers who are metastatic or locally advanced, or even earlier early ones who have a high Gleason score or who have acinar histology, they should undergo genetic testing. And if there is a mutation detected in the family, already detected in the family, then all the first degree and secondary relatives are eligible for testing. And even if there is a patient in the family, it is a close relative means first degree relative or second degree relative. If any of the first degree or second degree relatives have a personal history of cancer which merits testing, then that patient is also eligible for testing. These are the clear 4 points which are clarified in the NCCN guidelines, and we follow this.
Yeah, and very well said, Raja. And you will remember that when we were formulating our consensus document, I won't call it guidelines because of the reasons, we had this big issue of not kind of copying the NCCN guidelines, which is really wide and comprehensive, which has included all the cancers. In fact, it is so extensive that it appears that all cancers should have a genetic testing, which is not possible or feasible in our country. So these are some of the classical situations where you must have a testing done. And I think this is the list of the NCCN, and it's an ever-expanding list. Every year they add more into this. And I think very soon they'll say that every single patient who has cancer should have genetic testing. And we had a tough time in, you know, shortening down this list without really hardcore evidences from our country. And I think this is a question, again, which is of a lot of interest. Let me ask Reema this question. As already discussed with you, our patient has a 19-year-old daughter. Now, should this patient be offered genetic testing? And Dr. Reema?
Yeah, so typically, even with the BRCA1 and 2 mutation, the onset of cancer usually, so if you would have seen the cancer predisposition graphs that I had shown for the 185 del AG of BRCA1 and BRCA2, the graph usually starts from 25 years of age. So till 25 years of age, rarely anyone, even with anticipation, will develop breast cancer. And ovarian cancer develops a little later anyway. So we wouldn't, I mean, we can discuss this option with the 19-year-old because she's an adult, but testing and screening can be initiated from the age of 25. If the 19-year-old is mature enough to take the decision and wants to get the testing done, then as an adult, we can offer testing to her.
So that is, I think, a pretty dicey question in deciding whether a 19-year-old has achieved maturity or not. The person is mature enough to vote, the person is mature enough to drink, the person is mature enough to drive. So I guess, I know it's an arbitrary cutoff. One 18-year-old would be able to understand everything, and one 18-year-old would get completely hysterical if you give them this information. So it's like a lot of, you know, tightrope walking to do. And then you have that whole bunch of psychological problems, and that is where genetic counseling comes in. So the psychological aspects and the trauma which you induce has to be very, very carefully thought of and very, very carefully considered. So, Abhanna, you are also a genetic counselor of note. Would you agree to this?
I do when it comes to anybody under the age of, I know the NCCN says 18, but anybody under the age of 21, I get a little worried, irrespective if it's male or female, when it comes to doing the genetic counseling and recommending testing, because as you rightfully said, that while we may consider them to be an adult in taking decisions with voting and etc., but they can always rectify and change their mind with respect to those decisions. But we're taking a decision at the age of 18, 19 for something like genetic testing. I've seen both ends of the spectrum where sometimes it doesn't sit well with the children. And especially looking at our, looking at the Indian society per se, when you have a young 19-year-old girl who has a BRCA mutation, it can be considered a taboo because she's coming from that sort of a background. So at that young age, I would not, in this particular social setting, I'm not very comfortable. And no matter how tactful and how gentle a genetic counselor is in breaking that kind of information and however experienced you are, I do tend to feel that sometimes it could have major psychological implications, that even the slightest pain or the slightest fever and the child is thinking, what is suppose I'm going to get with my mother or my father or whoever has been, you know, whatever cancer has been there in the family. So I get a little scared at that particular age, but they are adults. If they want to do it, I obviously can't stop them, but I do give them a bit of both sides so they're aware before they make a decision.
So Vinay, what do you do in a situation like this?
You know, I couldn't agree more with what was just said. I mean, this we are a completely in a different social this thing. Forget young children, even adults don't really want to know with a family, strong family history. I've been counseling for years. I mean, it started really in 95 with guys when we had an genetics clinic. And when I came back, I tried very hard to set up BRCA testing, which didn't happen in early 2000s. And of course, now, of course, it's quite easily available. But even then, I find families, even highly educated families, well-to-do families, don't want to undergo. If you counsel them, they don't want to undergo testing. They don't want to know. They don't want their children to know. There is a social taboo. There is social discrimination, whether you like it or not, in our society. There is difficulty in getting married, in finding a partner, acceptance, understanding of genetics in our society. And this is really something very, very important. That's why I feel when we discuss genetic testing, I think we should be discussing counseling. Counseling is really the way to go ahead with our society. And testing should be carried out in people who actually want it and are motivated. I have patients who have walked into clinic for a second opinion. They have a BRCA test, which is positive. And I ask them, well, what have you decided to do about it? They say nothing. So I said, why did you do the test? They said, well, somebody told me to do the test. And that's how testing is being done in society today. So for a person who's so young, I mean, I think one has to be very, very gentle. And as you said, there may be some kids who are very, very precocious in our country who are quite ready for it and want to know. So in that small group, yes, I think you may follow whatever is mentioned really in the West. But I think you have to feel your way in our society with your patients and with their families.
Yeah. I think you have to individualize, and it's really, really difficult. You know, I'm very happy not to get into this whole jumble of things. When I just refer the patient to my genetic counselor, I'm lucky enough to have one DM in medical genetics in my institution. And, you know, I just pass my problem on to her.
Yeah, Hemant, just to
I have you, a question.
Yeah, Hemant, just to say that, you know, for years I used to do my own counseling. For the last 2 years, I do have an in-house genetic counselor, and it has obviously decreased the load.
Yeah, it makes a big difference. Yes, please, go ahead.
So, in this year's ASCO, there were two abstracts on this whole online pretest counseling. One was on HBOC, and I think one was on prostate cancer with BRCA mutations. So I was wondering how many on the panel are actually willing. They were both positive. They were both in favor of these online counseling sessions. How many are actually in favor of it given the COVID situation, etc.?
Well, might as the counselor is doing online counseling.
Okay.
As a routine.
You're comfortable with that, sir?
Yeah, what happened was she sits in my clinic with me. And if I mean, not, of course, that's off, but even then, the first time she would talk to the patient or in the clinic. And thereafter, most of the time, it would be actually be online.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, Aparna, one quick comment.
I just want to add that we actually did a survey in India last year. We actually published in ASCO with my team, and with using telegenetics as a model for genetic counseling and actually transferring, you know, this type of critical information. And patients are very, very receptive to it. The only caveat is that as long as you have somebody who's trained and understands the job and the profession, I don't think a patient suffers in that perspective. So the genetic counseling is carried out, and I don't want to say it's equal to a human touch, but even using telegenetics, it is a good model for, especially in today's situation.
Thank you.
Okay, I think I have such a learned panel that I could continue this panel discussion till 4 a.m. in the morning, but I don't think we'll be able to do that. Is Dr. Sudeep there? Sudeep, can you hear me? So I just wanted Sudeep's expert insight into this, and you know, I will quickly move forward and see if we can...
the internet, so you might have a listening.
So I think I'll just go to my conclusion slide, and some other time we will do all this. And all of us are aware of this Angela effect. Does this happen in our country, Vinay? You are the surgeon.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Because I've been counseling since early 2000s when I started, and there was hardly any acceptance.
Right.
And I can really see, I just, every time when I discuss with somebody, I speak about this lady. And I think she's done wonders, at least in our society. She's done wonders for acceptance of genetic testing, genetic counseling, and bilateral prophylactic mastectomy and oophorectomy.
So she improved your business and you're happy?
Well, not my business, because I refer to the gynecs for these surgeries, except the bilateral mastectomies are still not very popular, I must admit. Bilateral mastectomies, at least in my whole society, in our society, are still not popular.
So I think I'll go to my conclusion slide. I had some more cases to discuss, but we don't have time for that. So this is the document which we've come up with a lot of hope. I'm sure this will have lots and lots of flaws and problems. And I'd like to thank three people especially who worked very hard on this, three top people, Dr. Sudeep Gupta, Dr. Rajkumar, and Dr. Rajiv Sareen. It was actually Dr. Rajiv Sareen's baby. And then the three people who work with them, Dr. Pragya from Dr. Rajiv's lab, Dr. Nikita from Dr. Rajkumar's lab, and Dr. Raja Pramik from Ames. These three young people have worked very hard on this. I know I'm just there first because I just grabbed all the credit, but these are the guys who really, really did all the hard work. And this is my last slide. HBOC syndromes are not uncommon. Detailed family history and pedigree analysis are must. And it is not preferable but mandatory to involve genetic counseling and genetic counselors right at the first contact. And the patient requires intensive pre and post-test counseling. And patient requires to know all the possible effects and results of the genetic testing. I find that the variants of unknown significance is particularly distressing both for the prescribing doctor, for the genetic counselor, and for the patient. They tell us that you asked us to spend several thousands of rupees, and now you're saying you don't know what to do with this. Am I going to get cancer? Am I not going to get cancer? I'm sure each one of you has your opinion on that, but I don't have time to give those opinions. But this is a neglected field in our country. And I was very fascinated with the survey with Dr. Bhima showed that there's a very large number of practicing oncologists, maybe medical, maybe surgical, maybe radiation, who are very less aware of this syndrome and what needs to be done in patients who have a family history. And I think more and more contact and more education and training is needed for a lot of people. And with that, I'd like to, you know, thank all the speakers and all the panelists for this wonderful interaction. I wish we had more time. So thank you very much. So with that, I'll stop sharing my slides and hand over proceedings to Dr. Govind Babu.